I'm James Taylor, back with our bodybuilder character model. Last time we constructed the bodybuilder on top of photo reference. Now we're going to use that same photo reference to create textures in MUDBOX. I'm starting with my mesh imported into MUDBOX and I've subdivided it one subdivision level. MUDBOX works better when our mesh is subdivided. And then I'm going to go to the stencil tab on the bottom here and click that little button to add stencil. And I'll just load up the same reference I used to model on top of. We'll see it's added to the stencil menu. And when I click on it, I'll see that it pops up in the viewport. And I want to line my stencil up with my character mesh. This can be easier in the front view because there's no perspective. So I'll right click in the viewport, switch view, and then go to front view. I'll bring the stencil up again and I'll match my stencil and my viewport camera so that the character and the stencil line up. And now I'm going to use my projection brush to apply the stencil as a texture. So I select the projection brush from my paint tools rollout and I'll click on the surface and I'll get a create new layer option. For right now, I'm just going to choose 4096 and a 16-bit TIFF. So I'll use the projection brush to paint on the surface of my mesh and we'll see that it does what it says it does. It projects the stencil onto my character. And now I'm getting photorealistic detail on the surface of my character with very little effort. And in fact, most of our effort will be spent trying to get this stencil and the model to line up. So you'll see I'm moving and rotating this stencil to fill in the blank areas where the initial projection missed some detail so that I can go back and fill it in. While the front is projected well, we get errors all over the other places. So we're not going to be able to get away with one projection. We're going to have to do more. So I'll create a new layer and this will be for my side projection. And every new projection gets its own texture layer. We'll see why in a minute. So I'll switch to my orthographic side view, same way I did with my front view camera. And again, I'll try and position my reference and my character to match each other as closely as I can. When I switch back to perspective and I tumble around, I see that I have those same projection issues that I had on the front view. So we'll see that the side view actually covers up some of that front view, and we need to use our eraser to reveal the parts of the front view that we want to keep. And this is why we project every projection on its own layer. One quick note about the eraser, it's extremely strong. So we're usually going to stick with very low values for the eraser. And I'm just going to get rid of everything that I don't need. And I'll repeat the process for my front view layer. Okay, let's do another projection. I'll switch back to the front orthographic view. And I'm going to project my head from the front as its own projection. Matching up the fine details on the head and face is extremely important for capturing the likeness of the character. But when we're projecting, we'll note that the ears don't match up. And we need to edit our stencil so that they do. So I'll go to the Edit menu and choose Edit Stencil. Edit Stencil is a powerful tool that allows us to change our stenciled images by either painting or sculpting them, so that we don't have to leave to go back into Photoshop to make changes. So in this case, I'm going to go to my sculpt tools and use the grab brush to push and pull my stencil into shape so that the ears match up better. When I'm done making changes, I'll hit done and then I'll switch back to the projection brush. And now I'll see that the projection of the ears works a lot better. So onto the side view of the head, I'll do another projection here. And again, I'll create a new texture layer. Every new projection gets a new texture layer. And I have the same problem here where I can project most of the head, but the ears still don't match up. So I'll use my grab brush to just adjust the position of the ear to match my reference. Once I'm happy with the projection, then I'll turn my eraser on again and I'll work on blending between the front and the side view. Now, adding all these layers will have performance ramifications. It's going to slow down MUDBOX. We need to optimize. So with only my head layers visible, I'll right-click and choose Merge Visible, and I'm collapsing those two paint layers into a single paint layer. I'll turn the body layers back on, and then I'll merge those down too. And by merging visible, we're reducing the number of textures that are applied to our surface. And so our video card and MUDBOX are going to run a little bit better. Now on to the back. So I'll turn my back projection on. I'll tumble my character around. Just try and match it up the way that I did with the previous projections. Again, it gets its own texture layer. Every projection gets its own layer. And then it's a matter of wrestling with it to get it to match my mesh as closely as possible. I can use my edit stencil again to pull that leg into place. So I'll use my grab brush again and just move the leg over so that it matches. Once I'm done projecting, I'll tumble around to the front and I'll see that a lot of the back ended up on the front. And I'll use my erase brush to just take care of that. But if I use too big of an erase brush, the exact same problem happens. I'll get the back part erased even though I'm erasing on the front. So when I'm erasing this kind of projection, I want to use a smaller brush. It takes a little bit longer, but it's the only way to do it. And when I'm done there, I'll create a new layer and I'll start to project the back three quarters. And this is the basic process that we'll follow for every part of the character. We'll take as much texture reference as we can get our hands on, and we'll project it from as many different angles as we possibly can. The overall workflow is to create a new layer for each projection and then blend it into the rest of the layers. In this way, we'll end up with a character that's covered from all angles, and we'll get nice high-resolution texture detail. And at this point, we've got pretty good coverage, but I want to fill in some of the gaps, so I'll turn off all my textures and make a new layer. And this is going to be a base color layer, so I can just fill it with a background flesh color. So with the paintbrush selected, I can scroll down to the bottom of the brush palette on the far right of our screen and just hit Flood Paint Layer. And that'll fill my paint layer with whatever base color I've chosen. And my goal here is to give something that blends down to a pretty basic flesh tone. And now that I have this brown base coat, I can edit my layers individually and just go through and clean up all the rough edges. So deleting the white backgrounds is a lot easier now because they're going to be a lot more visible against that new base color. And once I'm done cleaning up all the edges on my texture, I'm going to have a mesh that's completely covered with texture detail. And now I need to worry about blending my textures together so we can see various areas aren't matching up, like the side and the front of the arm. So I'll select the side arm layer, right click, and choose Adjust Color. I'm dialing down the value that'll darken the layer, and we can see that it matches a little bit more closely. But when I darken it, it tends to gray things. So I add saturation to it, and that intensifies the color just a little bit. But I also have adjustment brushes that allow me to make more localized changes. So here I'm using the dodge brush and I'm affecting midtones, and the dodge brush just brightens shadowed areas and works the same way as it does in Photoshop. Now this is a good start to the blending process. There's another technique I like to use. I'm going to create a new overlay layer. It can be relatively low resolution because it's just going to be a color layer. And I'm going to use a paintbrush and sample one of the average colors on the body. And I'll just paint this color into areas where the blending could be better. So we'll see that there's a lot of different hues across the body. We're going to unify that by using this as an overlay layer. So I'll paint that in, and then we'll adjust the layer blending mode. I'll try hue at first, but when we do that, we'll see that it doesn't really make a big change. So I'll try overlay next. Overlay is too much of a change. So I'll try soft light, and soft light gives me a good mix of matching the color without changing the value too much. As another example, you'll see that I've started to paint in with really strong, bold colors, and this ends up looking incorrect. It looks really weird. So we're going to use another feature, layer masking. So I'll right-click on my layer, and I'll add a layer mask to it. And now I can use a black and white paintbrush to mask off areas so I can get much more subtle effects. What we're not going to do is take a single color and brush it over the entire model because skin tone changes in color across the entire body. Keep this in mind when you're blending your textures together. Okay, at this point you'll see I've got an awful lot of layers in my scene and it's going to cause performance problems. So it's time to start consolidating by using Merge Visible. I'm going to turn layers on one by one or two or three at a time. And my goal is to reduce the number of texture layers while preserving all possible detail. Okay, let's switch tracks to a different technique. I've got a lot of seams like this that I want to fix. I'm going to use Flatten to UV Space, so under the UVs and Maps menu. And that'll basically reduce my mesh to the shape of its UVs which means I can paint on it as if it's a flat surface. And to paint out these seams, I'm going to use a new brush, my clone brush. And our clone brush works basically the same way that it does in Photoshop. I'm going to hit Control to sample an area, and then when I paint, it'll copy the paint from that area and paint it into whatever area I'm painting on top of. I can also use stencil projections in this UV map mode so that I can take detail from various areas on my stencils and project that in to help cover up whatever seams I have. So here I'm using the front view to just add some of the nice pixel detail from the high resolution reference into that area. I want to make sure that I maintain detail like skin texture and moles, all the tiny little details that create a really nice looking high resolution texture. Once I'm done editing in this 2D mode, all I have to do is go back to the UVs and maps menu and choose unflatten from UV space. And then my character will switch back to normal. And now I'll focus cleaning up these seams in the 3D mode. So again, I've hidden the arms. I'm looking at the side seam, and now I want to fix that. And I'll use my clone brush again to just sample detail from the surrounding areas and to overwrite that seam so that we get a nice smooth blend. I can also use my stencils to blend this detail. And again, I'll zoom in pretty close on the stencil to make sure that I'm getting high resolution pixel detail. Now we'll look at fixing the shoulder and neck seam. And we've got the seam at the shoulder and the neck is on its own entirely different set of UVs. So the only way we can blend this together is by using texture projection. So you'll see that I've got my front view reference and I'm zoomed in really closely to capture that pixel detail. The texture on the neck is really distinctive, so I'll use my clone brush to propagate that throughout the area. And then I'll rely on my stencil to just cover up the major texture seams that we can see. I'll also run into the exact same problem on the back, where I have the seams between the neck and the shoulders and the arms. And then I always like to do a once-over to just double-check that there aren't any seams showing. Basically, every time we run across a UV seam, this is how we're going to use projection painting to fix it. Now let's look at using these same techniques to project another difficult area, which is the inside of the arm. So I use my Select Faces tool to select my body and hide it so that just the arms are visible. And I'll start with the projections that I have. So I have some 3/4 images of the arms, and I can use this to selectively reproject some high resolution detail, in this case for the forearms. But we'll see that it doesn't cover anything up above the forearms, so then we have to improvise. So what I'll do is I'll use the outside of the arm and project that on the inside of the arm to fill in a lot of that missing texture detail. And we can get away with this because the textures are generally similar, but also because the inside of the arm is an area that the viewer is not going to have the chance to scrutinize an awful lot. Here I'm using my mirror tool to project the outside back portion of the forearm so that I get a little bit of texture detail on both sides. But in general, I don't want to use mirroring when projecting. I want to have as many unique pixels from my image reference as I possibly can. So we'll see here, instead of just mirroring the texture detail from one arm to the other, I'm actually going to paint an entirely new texture on the inside of my other arm. And with that, we're done. We finally got a completely textured character covered head to toe. When we zoom in, we have nice high resolution detail. So how do we get it out of Mudbox? Well, I'm going to merge visible on all my layers, and then I'll select the resulting layer, call it whatever I want, and then I can right click and export selected. However, there is an easier way. I don't have to delete all my layers. I can just export channel merged. And that'll save me a step. I won't have to merge visible. And I'll just save it out as a TIFF format wherever I want. And now I'm going to bring it into Maya. So back in Maya, I have my character with his two separate materials. And if I look where I saved my files, I'll see that Mudbox saved two separate files out. And that's because it saves one file per UV set. So the head and the body are saved as separate files because they're on different UV tiles. And this means that I can plug in my textures to my different materials. So I select my head material and I'll navigate to the head tile that Mudbox exported and plug that in. And now I've got a head assigned and I can do the same thing for the torso. Because of the way Maya draws a viewport, things look a little gray. So I'm going to add just a little bit of red to the incandescence channel on both of my materials. This will liven things up, make it look a little bit more like skin tone. It is a total old school fake though. You definitely don't do this before you render, strictly for the viewport. And with that, we are finally done. We've got textures on our character. The character looks a lot more like the photos of the person that they're based on. We can see that we're missing a few things, namely anatomical structures, muscles, fun stuff like that. That comes next in the sculpting pass, where we add more detail. I'm James Taylor. Thanks for watching.